Tonight, I hope you come ready to receive what God's got for you. I know that I need a refreshing tonight in the Lord and in His Spirit, and I'm looking forward. Been looking forward to this all day. Sometimes Sunday and Wednesday are a little too far apart. Well, they're about the same every week, but it seems like it. But I like getting together with you, my family. And in the Spirit of God, there's something God does in corporate worship. And He releases His Spirit, and our hearts are touched and our lives are touched. So I just encourage you tonight, whatever you need can be found in the Spirit of God. And I say this all the time. Sometimes what you think you need and what you need are two different things. What you think you need is money or this or a girl or a guy or all these different things, but what you really need is just Jesus and seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and He'll take care of the rest of that stuff. So I just encourage you to seek Him, and let's enjoy His presence tonight. Father, thank You for this time in this place, God, a night that You've ordained to do great things in the hearts and lives of those that are seeking You. Maybe even those tonight, Father, that they're just here. They come because somebody wanted them to, and it's not really the desire of their heart. But God, I pray tonight that You would so touch everyone in this room that we would all be drawn to You. From those who've known You 20, 30, 40 years, and to those who tonight will be the first night they've ever tasted to see that You are good. God, do something in this place for someone. Lord, You know every heart. You know every life. You know every struggle, trial, tribulation, temptation. You know it all, Father. You see into our lives, Father God. And we just trust You tonight to move in everybody's life like it needs to happen, God. Lord, we just give You all praise. God, we ask You for all distractions to go away, God. For everybody to be tuned in to You. We ask You to bind the devil, all his forces, his minions, his demons, the strongholds that he's trying to keep on people, the addictions and the things that are in this room. Father God, we pray that You release those that are in this room from those things in Jesus' name. We ask You to raise up mighty men and women of God that would show people Your love and Your mercy and Your grace and Your light, God. They would shine Your glory throughout all the earth. Let this night be a night of life-changing meeting with You, God. We do not desire to be anything but a presence-based church. Let us run after Your presence tonight. Accept our worship as pleasing to You, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening soul. worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and slow to anger. Your name is great, on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending.
Thank You, Lord.
10,000 years and then forevermore.
Forevermore.
Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name.
We are here to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that holy name, the name of Jesus, the name that is above all names. We bow to that name tonight. Yes. Father, You are the King of our heart. We proclaim You as that. You are the King of this world. Father God, we give You all praise. Lord, we do not lift anyone's name higher than Yours. So let this not be just a song, but let it be our heart. Let it not just be a sound that comes from our lips. Let this be the song of our heart in this place. Let everybody know You as King of their heart.
Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good, good. Oh, You are good, You're good. Good. Oh,
He's so good. He's so good. He's so good.
once and for all, once and for all, you offered up your life for one and all, for one and all, the perfect sacrifice. Atoning blood was shed, love conquered when you said, it is finished, it is done, to the world salvation comes. Hallelujah, we're alive, hell was silence when you cried it in. This King, who is this King? Who is this King? So mighty and so strong. He is the one, he is the one the earth has waited for. God's remedy for sin, with mercy for all. The sun bowed its head. The veil of the temple was open for man as Jesus went down in the cold of the grave, defeated the darkness when he overcame. The keys to the kingdom were placed in the hands of children and priests and fishers of men. Through all generations his voice will be heard. Sun bowed its head, the veil of the temple was open for man as Jesus went down in the cold of the grave, defeated the darkness when he overcame. The keys to the kingdom were placed in the hands of children and priests and fishers of men. Through all generations his voice will be heard. It is finished, it is done, to the world salvation comes. Hallelujah, we're alive, hell was silence when you cried. It is finished, it is done, now completed the work of love. Hallelujah, he's alive. Join the song of the ransom bride. It is finished. It is finished. Give him some praise tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise you, Jesus. We worship you. Father God, we know if you wouldn't have said it is finished, we would have been finished, Lord. But we know because of your death, burial, and resurrection, it's not the end of us. This is just the beginning. And for all eternity, Father, we will give you the praise and the honor and the glory you deserve because you said it is finished. It is paid in full today. We enjoy your glory. And may your fame spread throughout all the earth, God. May we never be silent about the one who gave his all for us. Lord, we love you and we praise you tonight. And we ask you to change somebody's heart here in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated for just a few minutes as you sit down. On Wednesday nights, we take up a van offering. If you want to know what that is to our...
Matthew chapter 6. Remember that we've been kind of delving into the four things that Acts chapter 2 said the early church gave their lives to, which we should give our lives to also. They gave their lives to the apostles' teaching. We should give our lives to the Word of God. They gave their lives to fellowshipping with each other. We should give our lives to going to church. They gave our lives to eating together and meals together and the Lord's Supper together. And they gave their lives to prayer. And I think that's a good for all of us. If we had to say, what are going to be my priorities in life? It should be the Word of God. It should be each other. It should be the house of God. It should be getting to really know each other, not just a surface knowledge of each other, not just a passing on Sunday. The church was never meant to be just a passing of people who really didn't know each other, who came together on Sunday. There's no way to have intimate worship with people that you are not intimate with. There's no way to do what we need to do in community if we're not intimate with each other. So we have to see those things. We have to go farther than the average church is going today. And then the last thing we were talking about is the prayer. Matthew chapter 6, we're talking about the model prayer, not the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is John 17. The model prayer is where the disciples have asked how to pray and Jesus is teaching them. Last week we talked about may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we think about what's going on in heaven. We talked about that, just a little more about that this week, and then we'll move on to the next line. Does anybody, before we get started, have a answered prayer that they were praying specifically about that they saw God move? Because anytime we can testify to something that we're reading or studying, what God's done in your prayer life, something you're praying about, it's uplifting to those who are listening who might be praying about something that hasn't happened yet or something they need or something going on in their life. So is there anybody tonight that can testify to a prayer that they had prayed specifically that God has answered in the last week? Anybody? Amen.
And he's given me peace and serenity ever since. I mean, it was instantaneous.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Sometimes you just got to give up. Amen. Amen. Specifically, they wanted a home. They got a home. Amen. Specific. That's why when somebody says, I need you to pray for me, I say, you want me to pray that your car breaks down? You want me to pray for you? You want me to pray that a hammer falls out of the sky and hits you in the head? What do you want? You know, like, let's be specific here. I don't mind people having unspoken prayer requests, but that's hard for me to pray for. I mean, somebody's got to ask God for specific, and I like to be specific with what's going on. Family, we're family. Let's be specific with our prayers. If we ask somebody to pray for it, we ought to be able to trust them enough to be specific with them that they'll speak to God about it, not speak to everybody else, you know. A real church doesn't speak to everybody else more than they speak to God about the issues that's going on in the midst of all the people. Who else? Who's got something specific that you're praying about that God's done for you? Anybody else? Yeah. Amen. I prayed for rain the other day three times. And the third time we got rain, I said, that's enough. So I just reserved. Next time I was only going to pray for it once. Because I prayed for it three times and it rained three times. And by the third time I was thinking, it can't handle no more water in my garden, you know. You say, well, you really pray for your garden to be watered? Sure I did. Yeah, it feeds my family. Sure I did. I pray for whatever I need. Amen. That's the thing we're going to look at here right now. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Verse 11, give us today the food we need, or give us this day our daily bread. As he said about the wills being done on earth as it is in heaven, we think about God's will in heaven. Everything that's going on in heaven is pure and perfect and holy. Everything and everybody in heaven is in full obedience to the Father. One thing I didn't touch on a lot last week on them first two lines was when we pray for God's will to be done. So this is the model prayer. This is how we are supposed to be praying. When we pray for God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, we are actually praying for ourselves to align with the will of God. Like when we pray for your will to be done, then that actually puts us into action in doing what His will is, because the way His will is done through us is that we live according to the Word of God, the things of God, the things God's put before us. So there's actually some action on our parts when we say, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We have to step into obedience. Obedience brings blessings. Disobedience brings curses. We see that all of our life. You want the blessings of God, you walk in the favor of God, you have to walk in the ordinances and in obedience to God. It's just the way this works. So we pray for His will to be done, and then we pray. It kind of changes. The first part of the prayer has been praise and adoration. It has been the declaration of who God is and what He is and how He is and where He is and our submission to Him and His will. And then it goes into petition. All prayer is praise and petition. And if you're not praising God, then you're talking to God. You're asking God. It's okay to ask God for what you need. I think sometimes we think, well, God doesn't want to be bothered with this, or this is small. I can do this myself. Boy, I've heard a lot of good people say that. And everything I've ever touched is broken or failed. And if it were not for God, I'd still be in a mess. I mean, at some point, you've got to quit doing what you're doing and let God do what He's doing, start doing what He wants you to. At some point, you just got to stop and trust God. Like when you acknowledge God in your prayer, when you're praying, you say, God, give me this day what I need. You're acknowledging that in and of yourself, you do not have the ability to actually get what you need without the Father giving it to you. It's a prayer of submission. So if you said, if you didn't pray like this, if you just thought, I'll handle it, then who's God? You're God. You're going to handle it. You're going to make it happen. You're going to do this. Look, the best laid plans of man fail. When you say, I think I'll do this tomorrow, I think God laughs. Or when you say, when you were a kid and you said, when I grow up, I want to be. I never said a preacher. You know what I'm saying? Like I was like a firefighter or Navy SEAL or something. I was killing people or jumping out of planes. I was going to be something besides a preacher, you know. And then God's like looking at you saying, you don't know what you want. You don't know where you need to go. You don't know where this is. You need this. You have all these things that you can't handle. And sooner or later in your life, you're going to have to reserve yourself to praying a prayer that says, God, I can't, but I know you can. That's what this is. You say, well, it's just talking about our daily bread. There's so much. Listen, it's just talking about the need that you have for this day. This day. See, I heard a preacher, I believe it was Matthew Henry's commentary I was reading, where he said, you can't live off the bread of yesterday. You need new bread today. Like, and maybe that goes for church people. Listen. You can't just live off an experience you had with God 40 years ago. I mean, you're wanting to, His joy is new every morning. His spirit is fresh. His goodness is better than it, yeah, it's better today than it was yesterday. The more you grow in God, the more you're with God. You know, so this is not only, I believe, a physical thing, but a spiritual thing. We are asking God to give us what we need. You say, well, I don't want to bother God. Did Jesus tell you to pray like this? Is that what he's saying? And Jesus was God manifested in the flesh. So when you see Jesus, you see a picture of the Father. That means right here the Father saying, please ask me for what you need. You know, there's some of you in this room that don't have what you need right now because you're not asking for it. You'd rather sit and want than to just say, I can't do this. I have to have you. Your pride is keeping you from getting what you need. Your pride, you're just saying, I'm a man. I should be able to do that. I'm a man. You know, the problem with men, and because I'm not a woman, thank the Lord, but the problem with men, I can speak to that one. I don't know about women, I'll never say the problem with women is, because that'll really get you in trouble. I know better than that. The problem with men is we think we can handle anything. We can handle anything. We can do anything we want. We are men. We are strong. We are smart. We can do what we need to do. But at some point, when Jesus said, follow me, when he said, take up your cross daily, what he meant was every day you've got to die to the fleshly man and say, God, I can't, I'm going to put my flesh upon this cross today, and my spirit man's going to walk with you, and I'm going to kill everything that's not of you. And every day I'm going to check my pride. When I get out of the bed, I'm going to take my pride and stuff it under the bed, and I'm going to walk in allegiance to you this day. I'm not going to do what I'm not supposed to do. I'm not going to say what I'm supposed to say. I'm going to be what I'm supposed to be. I'm going to do what you want me to do this day. Father, give me what I need. Now, all of our needs are different because we're all in a different place in life. What I needed when I first got saved is different than what I need now that I'm 16 years in. I pray different prayers now. My life is different. Five and a half, 6 years ago, I was praying for my family to be restored. I mean, life's different. Things happen. We're different. We go through seasons and valleys, but we always have needs, and we just got to see that God, it says, every good gift comes down from the Father, which is above. So you need, it might be this simple tonight. You might need food in your cabinet. So this could be very literal for you. Give us this day our daily bread. You could be hungry right now and not know where your next meal is coming from. But if you're a child of God and you ask Him for food, I can promise you, you'll eat a meal. Okay? Whitfield, all the old evangelists, the ones that ran the children's home and all that thing, the things that we read about in the history of Christianity, I believe it was George Whitfield that had the children's home. George Whitfield had a children's home where he took in orphans and different ones, and he had a bunch of, like, 60 kids in this orphanage. And one night, he was praying. They didn't have nothing to feed the kids, nothing to give the kids to drink, anything. And, like, he's taking care of them. He is their only man. He's this man of God. He said, I just got down on my knees. He said, I started praying, and a milk truck broke down in front of the orphanage. They knocked on the door and said, if we don't give you this milk, it's going to spoil. Could you use it? Sure we can. Thank you, Jesus. Here, we've got some milk now. Now, what if he'd just been like, well, what are we going to do? Just sit there. That's why I'm saying some of you got issues that you need resolved, and you're too hard-headed just to say, I need help. Lord, I need help. I cannot get out of this situation by myself. I cannot rectify this situation. I cannot change the mess that I'm in unless you come down and you redeem it. It could be food. It could be a bill. It could be your marriage. It could be 100 different things that you need right now. Today. Take care of today, though. That's one thing. I think we worry so much about the future that we don't take care of today. Are any of y'all guaranteed tomorrow? I'm not. So to live today for tomorrow is foolish. To waste today hoping to get to tomorrow, one day that's not going to work because there will not be a tomorrow. Give us this day our daily bread. And God, whatever you do this day, we'll thank you for it. And if we go to bed tonight and we get up again in the morning and you give us another breath of life, then we're going to ask you for some more bread. Get me through this day, just one day at a time. I know we all have these places we think we need to be and these things that we need to do, but we despise the process that gets us there, like today. Heck, who doesn't want to be retired or this or that? And doesn't want? Listen, today is more important than then. You might not even make it to here. Just live today. And I heard a guy say the other day that this thought has changed his life completely. The grace of one more day. The grace of one day. If you get one more day, live it to its fullest. Love it. Enjoy it. Love your family. Love your wife. Love your kids. It don't get no... guys, it doesn't do any good to get upset ever. You know, it don't do no good to fuss and holler and do all them things. You get mad at your kids because they ain't acting right. And the last thing they might remember if you die tonight is how you yelled at them right before you went to bed instead of telling them you love them. You know, live in today. Love today. The grace of one more day. God didn't have to give you another day, but he gave you one more day. The grace of one more day. If we would think about that every day we woke up, I got the grace of one more day, and I am not going to disappoint my Father in this day. God, give me what I need. Give me patience. Give me strength. Give me provision. Give me the food. Give me the wisdom to make right decisions. Give me a love that transcends all evil in the world. Give me boldness that I might speak the word of God. And you say, give me. Yes, if God doesn't enable us and give us, then we'll never ever be what he's called us to be. The grace of one more day. Ask the Father for what you need. Whatever it is. You say, I need a car. Ask God for a car. If you need a car, ask him for one. And that's the truth about seeking first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6, 33. If you think about what he says there, he makes it, seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. You're seeking God. You're asking for God. You're living right. You say, he teaches in verse 25, that's why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food or drink or enough clothes. Isn't life more than food? Isn't body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in their barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you more valuable than a blackbird or a sparrow or a red bird? Some of you act like crows. But God loves crows too, you know? You know, he still keeps them around, okay? God cares for flowers. The reason flowers are so pretty is because God cares for them and he loves them. He loves flowers. And he says, I'm going to make these beautiful because they display my glory. And you think about that for just a minute. If God will paint that flower so beautiful that when you look at it, you see his glory, how much more will he do for someone he created to shine for his glory? mean, I just think we complicate this, and we look for the mystery in the Scripture when the mystery that we have is, why won't we just see it for what it is and just simplify this and just live it, just love it, just enjoy it, and look at that flower and say, man, that's beautiful. And if that's beautiful, I'm beautiful in the eyes of God. If look at that bird, he just does, if he feed, he's going to take care of me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to wonder. I don't have to fret. I don't have to have this sick feeling in my stomach all the time when things don't go my way, because it doesn't matter if it goes my way. Life isn't about me. It's about my Father. Life's about His glory. He's going to take care of me. Seeking the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, for He'll give you what you need. You know, I saw a thing from Max Lucado. He said, you know, God every day gives you a sunrise and a sunset, and He shows you all these beautiful things in life because He loves you. He just wants you to enjoy life. You know how much more easy it'd be if we would just enjoy life? I just don't think we enjoy life. I think we're so worried about the next step, the next day, the next thing, that one day I'm going to look up and my two-year-old's going to be 27 and I'm going to be in a wheelchair. Probably, more than likely. And there's no way I can go back to tonight when she's saying, Daddy, will you play Barbies with me? You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I don't play Barbies. I'm a tough guy. If you need something, ask Him. Talk to Him. Y'all come to me and say, I need this and I need this. If you ask God for it, don't ask your preacher before you ask God for it. You know, I have limited ability to fulfill your needs. And most of the time I'm not going to do it good anyways, okay? Trust the Lord. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. He will direct your path. Give us this day the food we need, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I just want to take the last 10 minutes and pray. We talk about it, so let's exercise it. Let's exercise some of the knowledge we have had given to us in the last few weeks, and just spend some time before our fathers. You can pray out loud if you want to. You don't have to. But I just want all of us to speak to God, us to Him. Like, I'm not going to pray for you. Nobody else going to pray for you. This is a time for you to pray and seek the Lord and just spend some time in His presence. Let's just all bow our heads and let's just try to get in the presence of God here for just a few minutes. Just think about what's been said tonight. And if you do nothing else.